CoWoS, backside power delivery, high bandwidth memory, 3D NAND. What do these next generation semiconductor technologies have in common? They all rely on some form of wafer bonding. Wafer bonding is low-key holding together the future of semiconductors. So, we need to know more about it. In today's video, we do an intro of this family of increasingly important but seemingly simple technologies, wafer bonding. This video is brought to you by the Asianometry Patreon. Early access members get to see new videos first and selected references too. Early access really helps a lot and I appreciate every pledge. Thank you, and on with the show. Silicon wafer bonding describes the bonding of two clean, highly polished silicon wafers. Press two prepared wafers together in a vacuum and at room temperature, and they stick. There are several forces behind this, capillary forces, hydrogen bonds, etc., but the significant one are van der Waals forces. First discovered and named by the Dutch physicist Johannes Diderik van der Waals, these are weak electric forces of attraction between uncharged atoms or molecules. These forces' strength depend on the wafer's distance, surface roughness, and whatnot, and they are very weak. So, to keep the wafers from accidentally peeling apart, we add a high-temperature annealing step. Virtually all wafer bonding techniques have this step in common, though there are differences in temperature, etc. Wafer bonding might also include the presence of a middle layer called an interlayer. For instance, you can bond two wafers using an adhesive polymer interlayer, glue, or solder. So yeah, gluing two wafers together is wafer bonding too in the stickiest sense of the word. Very cheap, though, not exactly leading edge, and not what most people are thinking about when they talk about wafer bonding. This bonding has been long known, though more as cold welding. This is where if you have two pieces of metal and you press them together in a vacuum, then they fuse. They don't have to be the same metal, but it works better if they are. Richard Feynman has this famous quote that every textbook seems to mention, I guess since it's Feynman. The reason for this unexpected behavior is that when the atoms in contact are all of the same kind, there is no way for the atoms to quote-unquote know that they are in different pieces of copper. When there are other atoms in the oxides and greases and more complicated thin surface layers of contaminants in between, the atoms quote-unquote know when they are not on the same part. People have been cold welding things since the 1700s, when the Reverend J.T. de Sagarier cold welded together two pieces of lead and showed that it took the same amount of force to separate them as with just one ball of lead. The phenomenon gained wider awareness in Europe's optical workshops, where advancing polishing techniques directly exposed the surfaces of glass. Optical workshop employees noticed that these polished glass surfaces fused when pressed together. The English had a phrase for it, ringing together, and the Germans called it anspringen. At first seen as an annoyance, they later used it for their own purposes. When the glass components have the same refractive index, then when cold welded together, you cannot see the boundary between the two, since there are no reflections. Thus, the first scientific studies done in the 1930s were optical related, first by J.W. Obrimov out of St. Petersburg in 1930, who studied the same effect in mica, a silicate, and then John William Strutt, 3rd Baron Rayleigh, in 1936. Yes, the Lord of Lithography himself. His paper studied two forms of the optical bonding phenomenon and discovered that they were the same thing. Cold welding continues to be a thing today. Space engineers in particular have to worry about it because space is a vacuum where nobody can hear you scream that the pod bay doors can't open because they cold welded together. And famously, in 1991, the Galileo spacecraft is traveling to Jupiter, and it failed to fully deploy its high-gain antenna because the lubricant rubbed away, and the antenna's pins and socket cold-welded together. So how did cold-welding make its way to the semiconductor industry? In 1969, Wallace and Pomerantz published work on bonding a silicon wafer to sodium glass using only a relatively low amount of heat, 500 degrees Celsius, and an electric field without the use of an interlayer. Today, this is known as anodic bonding, or electrostatic bonding, and we use it to most often join silicon and borosilicate glass wafers. Pretty basic, we put them together on a hot plate and apply a high DC voltage. However, the anodic bonding market is very small, estimated at maybe $20 million or so a year. There are not many market applications for it outside of the MEMS and maybe microfluidics industries. Wafer bonding really first entered prominence in the industry in the 1980s, whilst developing a new technology called silicon on insulator, or SOI. SOI is where we put a thin silicon wafer hosting the transistors on top of an insulator, usually silicon dioxide. Silicon on insulator. Name checks out. And then we put all that on top of another substrate for mechanical support. People have been studying SOI since the early 1960s as a way to increase transistor density. Most silicon wafers are about 500 micrometers thick, with the transistor layer taking up only about the first micrometer of that. So things like parasitic capacitance and leakage from short channel effects, they happen because of interactions between the thin transistor layer and the substrate beneath it. So thinning the device wafer and then sliding the insulator underneath those transistors cuts down on those short channel effects, thus saving power. The SOI structure is also rather robust against radiation exposure or abnormally high temperatures, making it particularly helpful for military applications. The military funded much of the early research. In the mid-1980s, two teams published pioneering research on wafer bonding. In 1986, J.B. Lasky published a paper on wafer bonding, detailing his work of fusing together two oxidized wafers to create an SOI. A year later, Masaru Shimbo published a paper covering a similar concept. Their methods were also quite similar. Both processes included a high-temperature annealing step. These two papers form the technological basis of modern wafer bonding technology, and for a long time, SOI and silicon MEMS-style sensors and actuators remained the major industrial use cases for this wafer bonding technology. That, of course, is no longer the case. We want our wafer bond yields to be good. How to ensure a good bond? There are a few factors. Prior to bonding, the wafers have to be made very flat and clean. If they're not flat enough, then areas on the wafer will not get bonded and we get bubbles. Surface cleanliness is also essential. Very small particles caught in between the two wafers will cause serious defects, weakening the bond by creating voids and again bubbles. A particle even just 1 micron wide can cause a bubble spanning several millimeters. For this reason, we must clean the wafer surface as much as possible and do the actual bonding inside a particle-free cleanroom. And then there is alignment. Anyone trying to stick something onto something else gets annoyed if things aren't properly aligned. Modern wafers now have copper connections passing across the bonding boundary, and misalignment of these connections are bad. In the early days, we aligned two wafers together for bonding using fixtures. But as tolerances got stricter, new optical-based alignment tools like those from EV Group in Austria have become more prominent. Let us talk about the basic types of wafer bonding, starting with the most ordinary. That is what we call direct wafer bonding, sometimes also known as fusion bonding, and the terms more or less mean the same thing. Direct wafer bonding is vanilla. We talked about the process earlier. Press together two wafers without an intermediate layer of material, in others no adhesives, and then run them through an annealing step to solidify the bonds between wafers. Direct bonding has three subcategories based on the nature of the wafer's surfaces. First, we have a hydrophilic surface, which has an oxide layer and water layer prior to bonding. Second, there is a hydrophobic surface. We remove said oxide layer with a casual dip in hydrofluoric acid. It's just hydrogen and silicon out there. And then finally, a third category of super clean silicon surfaces bonding under ultra high vacuum or UHF conditions. This is out of our scope today, but I added it for completeness. Today, direct bonding is used for bonding very thin layers like the ones for silicon on insulator. Since the layers are so thin, they're not self-supporting. So we direct bond them to a mechanical substrate for stability. In a similar spirit, we have backside power delivery networks, a forthcoming semiconductor innovation, where we move the copper wire networks, bringing power to the transistors to underneath those very transistors. Direct bonding is used in bonding the transistor device wafer to a carrier wafer for mechanical stability during a later thinning step that will allow the through-silicon vias, or TSVs, of the power delivery network to poke upwards and through. One of the major issues with fusion bonding is that second high-temperature annealing step. As it gets hotter, the bonds holding the bonded wafers together change. To get the strongest silicon-to-silicon bonds, the annealing temperature needs to be north of 900 degrees Celsius, silicon's melting point. Unfortunately, this is hot, and as you might guess, it can damage the silicon patterns like cheese on a delicious pizza. This was a serious issue for MEMS. Furthermore, when you heat up silicon, you run the risk of warping, which again brings up the issue of defect causing bubbles and voids. So how do we get around this? We introduce plasma to the wafer surface before we bond them. The plasma does several things. First, it destroys organic contaminants on the wafer surface, cleaning it. And second, it lowers the activation energy of reactions like those forming strong silicon to silicon bonds. Thus, we can reduce the annealing temperature from 900 degrees to 400 degrees. Plasma-activated bonding is a developing industry, but the market has high potential considering its current value for items like backside power delivery networks, where we need to keep the devices from not melting like cheese. Another major category of wafer bonding techniques is called metal interlayer, because it includes the presence of a metal interlayer to help the bonding process. There are a number of processes in this category. Soldering is one, but right now, one type of metal interlayer bonding process stands out above all others, thermocompression bonding, or TCB. There are many variants of the TCB process, but they all rely on some combination of applied heat, pressure, and metal interlayer. The only way I can think about this, and how you know that I am writing this right before lunch, is to imagine a hot-pressed sandwich. We apply heat from one of the two wafers, usually from the top, as well as pressure. In between the two wafers, there is a metal interlayer that diffuses out in between the boundary without entering a liquid phase. After the TCB is done, you end up with this grain. TCB has been around since the 1950s when Hughes Aircraft applied for a patent, but it is hot again today due to its importance to one of the hottest products in the market right now. The high bandwidth memory, or HBM, used for advanced AI chips like the NVIDIA H100 or B100. An HBM is not a single die, but rather a package of stacked multiple dynamic RAM dies on top of a logic base die connected with vertical TSVs. TCB is used to permanently bond the memory wafer stacks for several reasons. One, the heat is only applied in a limited manner from the top. Copper and silicon expand differently when exposed to heat, so high heat in an oven can cause the base die or laminate substrate below to warp and break. And two, the TSVs themselves are very small and densely distributed. Traditional solder joints melt into a liquid which can damage the TSVs. During TCB, metal atoms diffuse across the bond to form a grain without entering a liquid phase. On the downside, TCB is rather slow since temperatures have to ramp up and down. And if you rush it, then there are serious failure modes that hurt the package's long-term performance. There is also little tolerance for surface particles, though that's the case for all of these wafer bonding methods. We're also lacking good metrology tools for measuring overlay. Since the temperature is very high, it causes things to expand, messing with our ability to accurately align the wafers. One more thing, TCB has upper limits on how big of a die it can accommodate. We need more pressure to bond bigger dies, and there's only so much it can take. For a way deeper dive into TCB, I recommend the semi-analysis report. It's quite technical, but still accessible. So in the future, TCB cannot accommodate bigger stacks of DRAM memory. Ergo, Hynix and other memory makers are testing the next big wafer bonding method, one that combines the various bits of what we've been talking about so far, hybrid bonding. Hybrid bonding is a next-generation direct bonding technique with bits of metal interlayer bonding thrown in, with the goal of delivering the best of both worlds. We no longer use solder balls or even microbumps. The bonding is directly copper to copper. What follows is a rough recounting of how it works. On the surface of the wafer, we have dielectric and copper, with the copper recessed inside vias. As is usual with anything copper-related, we have a barrier layer to keep the copper from leaking into the rest of the wafer. We treat the wafers with plasma and then wash them. Then we carefully align and press the two wafers together at room temperature. The plasma treatment helps ensure a decent dielectric-to-dielectric bond. After that, we run the bonded wafers through the annealing, and there, the copper on the two wafers expand, meeting in the middle like the Soviets and Americans at the Elbe River in April 1945. No need to apply high pressure like with thermocompression bonding. Because this annealing step can be batched, and with multiple wafers together in an oven, you can process many more wafers per hour in hybrid bonding than you can with TCB. The throughput is higher. Another benefit of having the direct copper-to-copper bonding is that the resulting connection is shorter, which cuts down on parasitic resistance and whatnot. Hybrid bonding is basically a must for an HBM stack of more than 16 dynamic RAM dies, but there are a few downsides. Since wafers are directly touching, the surface cleanliness and smoothness requirements ratchet even higher. New methods and facilities are needed to ensure such cleanliness, which is why hybrid bonding is seen by some as a front-end process on par with making transistors. Again, for a way deeper dive into this technology, I would recommend the report from SemiAnalysis, though I do caution that it is pretty advanced. I want to thank an anonymous friend of the channel at iMEC for background information for this video. A few years ago, Intel redefined Moore's law from counting the number of transistors on an IC to counting the number of transistors inside a package. It is a sign of packaging's increasing importance in the industry. Scaling at the IC level can continue, but not at the same speed and cost as before. Down the line, it's going to get harder to avoid short channel effects and leakages. So the elevation of packaging as a technology is good for wafer bonding and its many variants. We'll be hearing a lot more about this technology in the coming years. All right, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.